Welcome back to the Providence Science and Faith Symposium and Him All Things Hold Together. Before the break, we heard Dr. Reeves present his first lecture in which he did some ground clearing for us and helping us to understand some of the misconceptions and misapprehensions Christians have about science. And now in this second talk, he left us on a cliffhanger there at the end of the first one, and now he's going to develop the constructive part of the proposal, how to trust an expert, becoming a wise consumer of science. I know the title of this talk has captured the attention of a variety of different people I've spoken to, and I know this has been a struggle for many pastors that I've met with over the pandemic as well. Dr. Reeves, if you missed the first talk, is joining us from Alabama, where he serves as assistant professor of science and religion at Samford University, where he also directs the university's Center for Science and Religion. He's the co-author of a wonderful little book called A Little Book for New Scientists that is a helpful book for any students thinking about getting into science or who are new to their science studies, or perhaps even for pastors or parents of those who are getting involved in science. During Dr. Reeves' presentation, you'll have the opportunity to post your questions in the Q&A. And if you have the Q&A tab open and you see a question that you'd really like to hear Dr. Reeves answer, you can upvote it by clicking on the thumbs up icon. And after the talk, my colleague, Dr. Dielschneider, will be facilitating the discussion, and she'll be putting some of those questions to Dr. Reeves. So once again, let's give another virtual welcome to Dr. Josh Reeves.
All right, thank you. Well, I did not want to do from start. Let me go back. Sorry about this. All right, so this is where we left off. How will we fools find the wise man, Augustine saying? And there's a kind of maybe modern kind of related phenomena that psychologists talk about, the Dunning-Kruger effect, which is the less you know, the more overconfident you become about what you do know, right? So in some ways, ignorance becomes dangerous because you kind of have overconfidence in your ability to know things about things that you have not studied. So this is kind of the kind of problems that we deal with thinking about how to trust experts. So I'm going to talk about two general strategies against science skepticism. The first one is just becoming better consumers of science. And this is one more focused on the individual level, about how do we as individuals better appreciate what science is good at versus what science is not good at. I think once you have awareness of kind of maybe the strengths and weaknesses of science, I think it helps you better navigate some of the things you might read on the news or see elsewhere in our culture. The second thing, which I've talked a little bit about in the question and answer of the last session, is creating a better information environment. How do we create a better environment, structures, institutions to allow us to better understand good scientific information? Because the reality is, at the end of the day, you could be a wonderful critical thinker, but if you don't have institutions that give you good information for you to consume, then you're going to be limited, right? So if you could be a wonderful person who's interested in natural world and science, but if you don't have the institution of science to train you well in terms of what information's out there, what's reliable, then you're not going to be able to make good individual choices. So it's a balance between the individual and the kind of communal aspect, which I'll emphasize. But I'll mostly be talking about number one for this talk. All right, so I think having gone through the different alternatives to kind of mainstream science, I think the issue is that we just can't get around that we're going to have to trust science in some ways. And so I think instead of saying everybody needs to think for themselves, I think the real kind of intellectual predicament that we find ourselves in is it's not about what you know, it's about who you trust. In the same way you are what you eat, you are who you trust in terms of information that you allow to influence your kind of model or your perspective on the world. And so this is especially true with science, because as one historian of science Naomi Oreskes from Harvard says, if we don't trust others or don't want to relinquish control, we can always do things for ourselves. We can cook our own food, we can clean our own homes, we can do our own taxes, wash our own cars, even school our own children. But we cannot do our own science. So it comes to this: we must trust our scientific experts on matters of science because there really isn't a workable alternative, right? So I think once you take this on board, the idea that there really isn't an alternative to trusting science, that doesn't mean you have to trust all science, but if you're going to have reliable information about the natural world, you're going to have to take that information on trust, because the technical knowledge of science is such that unless you've done the actual work studying it for yourself, then you're not going to be able to determine what is a good scientific experiment, what is good scientific data, and those sorts of questions. Now, having said this, I don't want to give the idea that it's blind trust, right? Because I do think there's too many experts to trust them all. And when you get out into the world, everybody wants to mimic the language of science, use the authority of science to prop up their own particular way of seeing the world. So I think this is especially, you see this with different disciplines that try to mimic themselves. In psychology, which I was a psychology undergrad major here at Stanford, we often call it physics envy, where you're trying to reproduce in psychology and the study of human minds the same sort of rigor and approach that you would approach have in physics, for example. And sometimes that actually just did not work, given the complexity of human nature and how we understand, the composition of light versus the composition of human nature, right? One is much more complex than the other. So one kind of quote that I like to do to point to this is a Roger Scruton, who was kind of a famous philosopher of politics. He says, the scientific thinker has a clear question, a body of data, and a theoretical answer to the question that can be tested against that data. The scientistic thinker borrows the apparatus of science in order to create the appearance of a scientific question, the appearance of data, and the appearance of a method that will arrive at an answer. So I think this is a real problem, especially on issues that are disciplines that relate to human nature, especially. I've heard one philosopher of science make that kind of quip that if you are a natural scientist, you've never taken a course on the scientific method because you just learn your science. They just teach you how to do your research. But if you're in the social sciences and these other sorts of kind of disciplines that want the authority of science, you often, the primary thing you do when you come into a graduate school is learn kind of the scientific method and philosophy of science, because it's not always clear cut how the kind of softer sciences can produce the same reliable data oftentimes as the natural sciences, right? So this is not to be skeptical of the social sciences or all the social sciences, but it is to say that we have to be discerning in the way that we trust experts. When I think one of the issues that we find when thinking about experts is, you know, you can come on and have like an expert on, climate change, and then you can have an expert on relationships, and you can have an expert on this. The word expert there has been kind of stretched such that it's hard to know if it has any clear criteria for what makes someone an expert, right? And so I think the issue that we face oftentimes when discerning is, how do we know that there is a true body of knowledge, a true community that knows something that lies behind what is claimed to know, right? Because what you really want is an expert to speak on behalf of a community of scholars or a community of knowledge and can help bring that knowledge to bear on your particular question. So I think the best thing to think about is, like, it's not blind trust or science skepticism. It's kind of critical trust is the way I think about it. So even if you can't do the science, you can ask questions that help you assess whether to trust. So the analogy that I use in my book is that if I go to a car mechanic, I may not have any knowledge whatsoever on how to fix a car or how the car works. But if my car mechanic says you need this particular part replaced, then I can ask all sorts of other questions. I can ask, does this place seem reliable? Does this person seem trustworthy? Does my car seem to be acting fine? You can ask all sorts of secondary questions that allow you to assess what is going on, even if I can't do the engine work myself. And that's true of any part of life, right? If you are trying to think about whether to start a diet, right? There's a million different diets out there. How do you figure out what is the right one? You think, okay, does this person have, a training and background? Does this person have experience? Does this person give results? All these sorts of things to think about when you assess things that you don't have the ability to know for yourself. So I think critical trust is that kind of middle ground between blind trust and complete skepticism. Now, having said this, there are many, many complications, and I don't want to somehow suggest that it's going to be easy to have this sort of critical trust. For one reason, is that oftentimes the way people get information is through the popular media. You get most people get scientific information through newspapers and those sorts of things. But it's really hard to be a critical consumer if that's the way that you get it, because that science that is presented in the popular media is the least reliable aspect of science. Those are the most apt to be either disconfirmed or superseded by other scientific results. So one of the issues that we face when we're, as a Christian, thinking about scientific experts is often things that we trust or are hear about in the news is the least reliable part of science. Nobody goes to reports in the newspaper what you find in a scientific textbook or something like that, which is more consolidated, more reliable science. And so this really creates a problem. One problem in particular is that there's this phenomena that sociologists of science have come up with to say that the further that a knowledge claim gets from its source, the more certain it becomes. And so I think that when you actually push through the popular narratives about science and get into scientific research, you realize there's always questions, right? There's always issues like, did we do this experiment right? Is there, are we really testing what we're claimed to test? There's all sorts of, it's not like 100% certain. There's always, range of confidence in particular scientific theories. I've even heard a psychologist once tell me that when you're reading psychology literature, you can't really use like last year's research because, it hasn't really been vetted yet. Even though it went through peer review, it still needs to, settle a little bit before you're really sure. But then if it's too old, then you also might have been superseded. And so trying to find that Goldilocks zone between what is the right amount of scientific information that you can really trust is difficult even for people who are in a discipline, much less outside a discipline. Also think journalists, the nature of journalism tends to be, you want people to be engaged and you want to take people's interest. And so it almost goes without saying that the most interesting parts of science often are the conclusions that are most outside what you would expect and may not last over time. And so being a critical consumer of science only coming from journalism, I think is a difficult issue. Another question to really wrestle with, and this is the issue that is maybe the main one when thinking about science. Does science approach the truth? Does science give us true things that we can take home to the bank? And I think this is in some ways a complicated question. And one way you can see this is through the example of Isaac Newton. On the one hand, he came up with laws of motion, laws governing physics that are true. They are true that you can use them even in the 20th century to send people to the moon, even though the kind of worldview that's attached to those, the interpretation, which is called the Newtonian worldview, that was attached to those interpretation is no longer accepted, right? So the Newtonian worldview was superseded by quantum mechanics and general relativity and all the things of the last century, all the physics of the last century. So on the one hand, you could say it's true. On the other hand, the interpretation we add to the the mathematical descriptions of nature change over time. So I think this one way to think about this is kind of distinguish between different levels of science. And so there is the empirical data, the kind of the experimental data that you get from the empirical things that you run. And I think this tends to be the most persistent through changes in scientific revolutions. So the kind of same sort of experiments that you can run in Newton's day, you can run in our day. And they're still going, if they're done well, they can still run the same sort of experiments. The issue is how do we interpret that data? How do we interpret what's being produced by the experiments? And those are kind of more mid-level theories, right? They're not huge global philosophies, but like, how do we interpret like a theory of gravity or other sorts of theory of light? All these sorts of things are kind of mid-level theories about the data. And then we have even a larger perspective, the larger narrative stories that we tell about the world and our place in it. And this for Newton would be much more about a deterministic world in which we're all governed by natural law and there's no freedom in that world, right? So that's a kind of a more philosophy perspective rather than even a scientific one. And so I think as Christians are being consumers, what you really need to distinguish is between the kind of empirical data and then the larger narrative stories that people tell you about science. That to me is the least persistent through time and the most unreliable part that people often add to science. And it's common. I mean, I was in a faculty reading group yesterday on a book by a neuroscientist called Being You. It's about consciousness. And you could tell that in the kind of empirical world that he works, there was a lot of really good stuff. But then in order to sell that book to the public, there was a lot of philosophy added in about being, you know, don't be worried about dying because, you know, you'll be completely unaware of existence like you are under anesthesia in a surgery, right? So, you know, when you read popular science, all of these things are kind of interspersed with each other. Now, if we're thinking about the science approach, the truth, I think the best answer is that we have different levels of confidence in the science depending on the science, right? So there's not one size fits all for all scientists to say, this science is completely true, and then it kind of filters over to the other science, right? So I think there are certain mid-level theories that I think it's hard to imagine us ever giving them up, like the periodic table, or a theory of the solar system, or our theory that there's bacteria. All these sort of things are mid-level theory about the data that is so entrenched that it's hard to imagine overthrowing them. But then there's other areas where clearly over time, the empirical data builds up such that you have to come up with new mid-level theory. And so I don't think you want to give a one size fits all for science. It says science gives you truth or science gives you this. I really think it's better if you're going to be a critical consumer to think about individual sciences. Okay, what is the data for this particular theory? What is the data for this particular issue? And think about it then. And then as you are consuming information, just being kind of attuned to the difference between the data being offered and then the interpretation of that data and then the kind of the larger kind of philosophical or worldview perspective that people are adding to that. Because I do think as a Christian, our Christian faith makes a lot of difference to number three. I don't think in most cases it makes a lot of difference for number two. I think those tend to be more narrow enough related to the empirical data that it doesn't make as much difference. So you could be a Hindu or a Buddhist or a Christian or an atheist, and oftentimes you can agree about whether there's a periodic table or other sort of mid-level theory, right? So I think this kind of recognizing different levels of science can help us think about it, because I think the thing that gives science, I think, its power is the empirical data. But what the public really wants from science is number three, answers. And that's what science is least able to give, I think, because it always has to go over the evidence, extrapolate beyond the evidence that it has to come up with a larger story about our place in the universe. And so I think being aware of that can help you become consume, you know, better idea of like what science is good at and what science isn't necessarily good at. Another way to think about it is like, what is the question? What makes science science? What are the features that science has that makes it different from other approaches to knowledge? And this is actually a surprisingly difficult question to answer. There, I think the standard, the consensus view of historians and many philosophers is that you're not going to find one thing that makes science different from other sorts of things, right? Because science covers so many different areas, whether it's experimental research, whether it's observation of astronomy, whether it's theoretical physics, which is very mathematical. There's all different types of methods and different approaches that are bringing, that are lumped together in the category of science. So I don't want to give the idea that you can just come up with one definition and this will neatly help you decide whether something is really science and whether something is really not science. But I do think, having said that, there is some clarity that can be looked at through the history of why did science start 400 years ago? What was the change? And I really think for many historians of science of that generation, it was seeing nature as a machine, but was a very powerful metaphor for understanding how things work in society. And so what does that mean by a machine? It means breaking things into parts. And so if you break your body, for example, into the different parts, whether it's, you know, the organs or the cells and the molecules, once you understand all the parts work, then you understand the whole. Or if you break down something in nature, like a natural phenomenon, if you break it down to the parts, then you understand the whole. It's a key kind of intuition of, I think, or a key strategy of explaining that comes out of the scientific revolution. And as a result of this, it also leads to very emphasis on precise measurements. Because if you talk about something very qualitatively, like just describing it in everyday language, it is hard for another scientist to really know if they're talking about the same thing. But if you can measure, if you can quantify, if you can do those sorts of things, those sort of measurements are translatable into other cultures, into other ways of doing science. And so kind of breaking things into things that you can quantify was an important part of the scientific revolution. And then the last thing is, if you really understand something, you can control it and make technology from it. So if you really understand, say, the cell, then you should be able to manipulate the cell in order to create like a better cell, right? If you really understand something, you can change it going forward. So I think this, to me, you know, not all sciences will fit in this kind of paradigm, but I think this is helpful kind of seeing what made the early modern scientific revolution different from what came before it. So if this is the case, if this is like a helpful way of thinking about what makes science distinct, then I think this helps explain where science struggles with certain types of explanations. So the first one is science struggles with human nature, right? I think when you try to explain human nature mechanistically, it works for a lot of part of the body. But once you start talking about the brain itself or the self itself as a machine, then oftentimes it just ceases to make sense anymore, right? So I have a quote here from C.S. Lewis that naturalism, or which I would say kind of this mechanism, goes on claiming territory after territory. First the inorganic, then the lower organisms, then the man's body, then his emotions. But when it takes the final step and we attempt a naturalistic account of thought itself, suddenly the whole thing unravels, right? Because if you can offer a kind of a mechanistic account of thought itself, then the way we reason about the world is not because we're seeking truth. It's because we're just we're guided by the laws of physics, which operate blindly without any concern for our particular wants or desires in the world, right? Atoms and particles of physics don't want things. And so if that's really the real story that's going on, then human nature is in some ways erased. But I think this is an overstep, right? I think a mechanistic explanation works well for a lot of things, but when you apply it to human nature, in especially there's still ongoing debates about mechanism in biology. Like if is it nothing but blindly, if it's just blind mechanism, then there really is no purpose in nature, right? So can we really, as biologists, look out onto nature and say things don't act for purpose? They just act because of the way that their parts are guarded by the laws of nature, right? So I think those sorts of questions where mechanism falls short is a key indicator where science comes up and struggles with its ability to explain things in the world. A second thing that science struggles is what to value. And I think this is one of my favorite quotes from Leo Tolstoy, the Russian writer. Says, a plain and reasonable working man expects science to tell him how he ought to live, how to treat his family, his neighbors and men of other tribes, how to restrain his passions, what to believe in and what not to believe in, and much else. But what does our science say to him on these matters? It triumphantly tells him how many million miles it is from the Earth to the sun. It tells him of the chemical components of the Milky Way, and he goes on and on. But I don't want to know all these things, says a plain and reasonable man. I want to know how to live. And so for me, this nicely captures when science is doing, staying properly in its sphere of influence, that it just can't answer value questions. It can't tell you how to live, how to believe, how to restrain your passions. Those are just things that science doesn't offer answers to. And so when you see scientists trying to bleed over into those sorts of things, then I do think you should have reason to be suspicious. I just read another book by an anthropologist about kind of anthropology perspective. And I kept having this feeling that much of the book was being driven by a moral agenda, like trying to bust myths in order to make society more fair, which I'm entirely for making society more fair. But it felt a little bit like the moral agenda, what we should value, was driving the science. And I feel like when that happens, I think that we need to be just suspicious in some ways, right? Science can't tell us things to value. Where science struggles also with the larger picture. So Nancy Cartwright is a very kind of well-published and kind of well-known philosopher of science. And she says, is this quite reasonable demand that scientific claims be precise and unambiguous and impose limits on how far the sciences can stretch? For not much of that world lends itself to that kind of description. So I think this to me fits with kind of the perspective that I've been offering. Science is really great in its sphere of influence, but once you try to push it beyond its sphere to answer all sorts of questions about human existence, it really starts to fall short. It becomes in some ways a philosophy, kind of a worldview, and ceases to tie itself to empirical evidence. So I think one way I've heard people talk about it, that science makes good medicine, but it's a lousy meal, right? It's very good for certain sort of things, for medicine, for healing, for technology. But when we try to understand all of our human nature and why we're here and what we live for, then it just is far beyond the ability to answer those sorts of questions. So I think if you put this together, that means that faith without science gives rise to superstition, and science without faith gives rise to meaninglessness. This is a kind of paraphrase of a quote by a Catholic Pope. And I think this nicely captures what I'm trying, articulates what I'm trying to say, is that if you just have faith without science, then you can often believe many strange things about our world. And when you go back, especially I was reading a book about a year ago about Christian views on magic, and there was such a in-depth magical view of the world that was going on even after the Reformation that I think felt very superstitious oftentimes, that you're believing in things that really are not happening, you know, putting people, witches to death because someone dies in your community. But then science without faith gives rise to meaninglessness. Like, you don't know what to live for. You don't know how to treat each other. You don't know why we're here. And so I think this is why they need to kind of work together to give an accurate picture of our world. So that's the becoming better critical consumers of science piece. The last piece is to talk about better information environments. And I just would say, in general, When we address complicated issues, or we encounter complicated issues in our world, what we really need is institutions to solve things. And so the example that I use in the book is the legal system, right? If you want to know someone is guilty, how do you know someone is guilty? Well, you can have your own individual opinion, but I mean, how do you really know someone is guilty? The best way that we come up with is that we have an institution, the legal system, and it has rules for argument, as rules for evidence. You get to give a positive case, you get to give a negative case. And then after all that is sorted through, then people make the best decision possible, right? And so I think that applies for the universities at their best. They do the same sort of thing. And other sorts of institutions help us to sort out complicated problems that no one person can answer for themselves, right? No one person, I think, can answer for themselves whether pharmaceutical drugs are healthy or not for them, or safe to use for themselves. But if you have an institution you trust that can bring together many different experts to check each other, their biases, then I think you can have much more confidence in the conclusion that they draw. So I think in general, when we come against these complicated problems, what we need is not impartial scientific experts. I mean, that'd be great to have, but what we really need is a process for experts to disagree with each other. And you know, I'll say a little bit about the pandemic in a second, but I do think I think the worrying things is that I think that the debates that normally would go on in public health were in some ways diminished a little bit, because there was a worry that their debates would be lifted up and taken out of context and put in the popular media, right? So in order to have really good, I think, public health, we need strong experts contesting with each other and when making these sorts of decisions, because they're complicated and no one person can decide for themselves. So what we need is what I call communities of critical thinking. And this is where Christian universities come in, right? This is why, you know, the universities are not the church. They're to support the church, because especially in the way that I think about what I do as an educator, is I'm bringing in students to consider the best of Christian thinking on different sides of an issue, so they can think for themselves, so they can make their mind up for how to think about these sort of things. But they're not thinking for themselves. They're really thinking through the minds of the best Christian thinking out there, right? And so having Christians disagree with each other in order to encourage the growth of the Christian intellectual tradition is a good one. I think very often in the churches I grew up in, critical thinking wasn't really permitted, because it was just decided this is what we think, and therefore we just need to defend it at all costs. But I think universities help, because they allow people from different sides to argue and to improve each other, like iron sharpens iron in terms of the way we think about the world. And so I think we need communities of critical thinking. So how would this apply to the COVID pandemic? So, I mean, obviously I'm not a public health expert or anything, but I would say a couple things that for me, this is what I would kind of my takeaway message. I would say from my perspective, science can't tell you how to balance competing goods. So science, the expertise of scientists in COVID, I think from a big picture perspective, it was wonderful. Like, we produced vaccines so quickly, we're able to predict, manipulate parts of the human body to kind of ramp up our immune system against the pandemic. But the issue that expertise really struggled with during the pandemic was really on the public health side. Like, how do you balance different goods relative to each other? How do you balance the need to protect the community versus the need to educate children versus the need for economics? All these sorts of things. How do you balance these competing goods? And I just don't think science can tell you how to balance those goods. That's a political decision. So I would like our politicians to take science seriously, but science is not going to be able to tell you how to answer those political sort of questions, right? So like the analogy I think would be, you know, if you need to have some sort of surgery and your doctor says, well, there's an 80% chance this and a 20% chance that, you know, science is good at giving you percentages about what will be the outcome, but it can't tell you whether this is the best thing for you or not relative to your finances and all these sort of things. That's just not a sort of scientific question to answer. I think also where expertise struggle the most is in public messaging. So I think oftentimes when you get into the weeds of public health, you realize that there's many different communities, many different groups that you're trying to assess risk for. But then the issue that you got into public messaging is that you're trying to give one simple message, one like bumper sticker message almost for different people in different situations. And that's, I mean, that's just extremely hard to do. I think when you, you know, I think science is really good at giving you like percentages of risk, and you can update those risks as you go along. But your risk might be different from my risk. Like if my risk in Alabama might be different than someone living in New York City, there's all sorts of different levels of risk. And to have one public message for everyone is a really hard message to do. And so I think having public messages that are more nuanced, more complex, while I know it runs the risk of like overwhelming the community, but I think actually that is a better way to go. And so the kind of the model of relating to the public that I kind of favor is called, is articulated by one scholar, like science is an honest broker, right? Science gives you like, this is the best. If you choose this option, this is what we think will happen. This is what we think will happen. But it's giving you honest options for you to choose. And that's really the job of politicians in the community to decide for the level of risk they want to hold. Also think in terms of the pandemic, it's also good to have critical trust of expert. But it's also, I think the questions need to come as real questions, not as the opportunity to debunk expertise. And so one way I think about it is my own kind of medical situation in the past year, where I had, I started having irregular heartbeat, and I had to, one doctor told me that I needed to have kind of a surgery to kind of, for my AFib to kind of take away the irregular heartbeat. And so what I did is I did a lot of research. I looked online, went to multiple doctors asking questions. And I felt like that was an entirely appropriate thing to do. I'm not putting myself in the place of the doctor, right? I'm not trying to come in there and say, well, have you really considered this? It's not a debunking exercise, but it's trying to get expertise to apply to my particular situation is an entirely appropriate thing to do. And in that case, I need to be very careful that I'm not trying to go around and find one cardiologist who would just tell me not to have surgery because I'm scared of surgery, right? You need to find someone who seems to really speak on behalf of the community of cardiologists that you trust, that seems to be good information. And then at that point, then I feel like it's entirely appropriate to trust. And so I think there's about critical trust means asking questions, but not trying to, you know, kind of a Twitter debunking aspect of expertise, which I think is too often the case. And then I think the last thing I would say is that what we really want is experts who speak on behalf of the community. I think very often I was uncomfortable with people who were looking to experts who were saying what they wanted them to say, but who were not really have any special expertise in public health or other sorts of things. So we need experts who speak on behalf of their community, but also are upfront with what they do not know, right? Someone who can really say, this is what I don't know, this is what I can't tell you, this is the risk. Intellectual humility and expertise is really crucial. And someone who updates their beliefs as evidence comes in. So someone who is not afraid to say, yeah, I was wrong then, and this is what I need to change now. For me, as a non-public health expert, as a non-medical person, this is kind of the kind of mindset, the framework that I look for how I find reliable information out there in the world. So the last thing I'll conclude with this is that we need scientific experts. One reason we need this is that if Christians don't engage science well, it actually makes the Christian community on the whole look very bad and almost like a cult, right? So Augustine, who I've mentioned numerous times, the kind of fifth century great theologian of the church, had a time when he was not a member of the Christian community. It was a kind of a sect called the Manichees. And in the Confessions, he describes that he started having these questions, like, why was the leader teaching this when the science of his own day says that? It seemed to be not in harmony with each other. And they kept telling him, just wait till the leader comes. Wait till the leader comes. He'll explain everything to you. Well, eventually the leader came, and Augustine says he started saying things that I knew were not true scientifically. And he says, if I can't trust this person on matters where everybody can see from reason and experience, then why should I trust him on matters that I can't verify, like spiritual matters? How should I trust him there, right? And so I think it's important for Christians to be reliable, relate reliable to the scientific community well, because we don't want to give the appearance that if we're going to deny things that are very apparent to scientists, then we're not going to be able to convince them well when we try to tell them about matters of Christian hope. So Augustine, this is the quote, another quote, he says, if non-Christians find a Christian mistaken in a field which they themselves know well and hear him maintaining his foolish opinion about our books, how are they going to believe about these books and matters concerning the resurrection of the dead, the hope of eternal life, and the kingdom of heaven, which they think their pages are full of falsehoods on facts, which they themselves have learned from experience in the light of reason, right? So there's people who are non-Christian, who see the natural world and learn things by experience in the light of reason. And if Christians can't get that right, then they're not going to trust the Bible, because they're just going to assume the whole thing is mistaken. So I think my conclusion is that many questions can't be answered by science, but once scientific knowledge has been confirmed and validated by scientists of many different backgrounds and cultures and perspectives, the job of the church is to accept that knowledge, showing why Christianity offers the most cogent explanation of the world in which we find ourselves. And with that, I will look forward to your questions.
Please join me in thanking Dr. Josh Reeves for an excellent second talk today in our Science and Faith Symposium. Thank you. Okay, so we will now move into a time of question and answer. I'll just remind all of you at the bottom of your screen that there is a Q&A button that you can click and type in your questions, and you may choose to do so anonymously. And you may also see at that Q&A screen thumbs up icon. And so you can upvote questions that you really want us to address in this limited time for question and answers. I'll also remind everyone that we are recording these sessions. And so you will receive an email in a few days with some additional resources and the link to the Providence YouTube channel where you can find these recordings at a later date. So just keep an eye out for those if you wish to revisit the session or to look at some sessions that perhaps you may have missed out on. So again, Dr. Reeves, thank you so much for your second talk today. I really like how you framed your comments about encouraging us to be better consumers and also encouraging us to promote better institutions, areas of critical thought and debate. And so I thought that both of those parts of your talk were just well-formed, a lot to take away there. I really enjoyed the mention of good medicine and the lousy meal, going back to that analogy. Mm-hmm. Certainly as a scientist, I agree with that wholeheartedly. And I liked how you talked about how science can tell us a lot about the position of the Earth, its distance from the sun, and perhaps how the Earth moves. But it can't tell us a lot about how we live our life on this planet and morals and values. And so I thought that that was all very well said. Thank you for that. So I'll go to a question that I think Lyndall posed at the end of your previous session, but I think it's still very relevant to the topics that you mentioned more recently. So this first question in the Q&A says, there is seemingly a trend towards trusting or at least engaging in pseudoscience and health and wellness in society. And they put in brackets essential oils and yoga. Can you speak to why these seem to be accepted by communities that may have a distrust of more concrete sciences? What would you say to that?
Yes. I've had some experience with that. I know I have had family members who were very skeptical of science, but got in really into the natural health movement and I often wondered, it's because they thought nature was created good. And if we just could get away from processed materials and to natural foods that would, you know, some theological rationale there. But I think in general, though, if you have a skeptical view that you've been taught of institutions in general, now I fully admit that institutions can go wrong in many ways, but if it's a blanket mistrust of institutions, then you will look for experts to lie outside the mainstream in some way. And so I think I see people who are just kind of more vulnerable because they just inherently gravitate towards those people who don't speak on behalf of mainstream institutions. And so I often think, especially in the church environment that I grew up, it's much more about face-to-face knowledge rather than trusting someone's, taking someone's word for it. So if you have someone in your church who said, oh, this really worked for me, that means a lot. But if they read in a newspaper, oh, this was helpful, well, they often mistrust the news sources they get outside. So I think also too, it's like face-to-face knowledge versus kind of impersonal knowledge that they just, I feel like there's an inherent mistrust for anything that they can't, they don't know the person giving the information to them.
That's such a valuable point. And I know that for myself and Robert, when we were organizing this event, we really wanted to bring in some scientists as well. And so we will have two scientists speaking later on today in the next two sessions, because that face-to-face interaction with scientists is really important. If you only hear about science in social media and the newspaper, that's only telling you small pieces of such a big, big field of science.
Yeah, I would agree. And I feel like in some ways, my own personal story of changing my skepticism towards science was a lot of it because I got to know actual scientists. And in my church and other places that I realized that the idea that there was a hugely blind error that all these scientists who are very intelligent people were just missing the boat that my 20-year-old self could see right through was just incredibly naive on my part. But having said that, I think personal knowledge is good, but you also want to make sure that the personal knowledge, someone who speaks on behalf of a community and gives you insight into that community, right? Because the reality is that science doesn't tell us anything. Scientists tell us something, right? It's always a person who tells you something. And so to kind of have some thought about why this person is allowed to speak on behalf of science versus this person, it's always a good kind of background question when you're kind of thinking about these questions.
Yeah, very true. And before we move on to the next question, I'm just thinking of some of the other voices and the other quotes and words of wisdom that you brought in your lecture. And I just wanted to remind people of Naomi Oreskes. Oh, you can't see that because I've blurred out the background there. Her good work on why trust science. You mentioned some of her work earlier on in your talk. And I just know of so many people personally that have benefited from her explanations on why trust science. And it just aligns so well with your work in redeeming expertise.
Yeah, I think the quote that I had from her is from that book, if I remember correctly. So yes, that was an influential book on me.
It sounds of that topic, yeah. So for all of you attendees, certainly Naomi Oreskes's book on why trust science and your work, Dr. Reeves, on redeeming expertise are just two excellent reads for times that we find ourselves in this pandemic. Mm-hmm. I'll move on to a bit of a different question. Robert has asked here, it seems to me that the request people have for science to provide us with a narrative about existence is not unreasonable. Surely the basic discoveries we make about existence should provide a significant contribution to this narrative. Would you agree with this?
Yes, I think, I feel like maybe, I don't know if I use this analogy in the book, but in some ways it's kind of like a detective story, right? So there are certain things when you try to reconstruct the past that you could know pretty confidently because there's multiple lines of evidence come in. And so that has to be taken into account for any narrative that you tell about the past. But having said that, that knowledge is only a tiny fraction of the whole story of the past. And I've heard, kind of a biologist talk about when we look in the past, it's like looking through a telescope, right? And so we see some things very well, but then there's other things that you don't see as well, especially the things I think relating to human nature. So I definitely would say that we need to take some accounts of the past definitely on board into the way we understand ourselves and our place in nature. But I'd also, having said that, I also think that there's some things that science does not see very well or can't really see. And so putting those together is the real complicated question of how to bring science and faith into conversation with each other.
Okay, and so it seems like we have another upvoted question up here. Terry asks, evangelicals often see science as eroding biblical authority. How can we reassure them?
Yes, when I teach students, the thing that I don't do is like, hey, let me give you all the science data that kind of goes against your interpretation of the Bible and just update it, right? I find that to be not sensitive and not caring for their situations. What I do, in fact, do is actually help them read the Bible in detail. Like, hey, you love the Bible, let's read it together. And so when you read, say, Genesis 1 and Genesis 2, and you see, oh, there's two different creation stories. Oh, there's a different order of creation. Like there's one has the land first and then water, and then one has water then the land. Oh, this is an interesting question. How do you make sense of this? And so I think if you read the text well, these questions naturally arise, is one thing that I would say. And then also the thing that I really encourage is that I tell my students, I'm really going to bring them the best of Christian thinking. So give them a range of options and encourage them to see this as part of their development. And so I think as long as Christians feel like you're giving all sides kind of a fair shot, they feel like they're comfortable. Like, yeah, I'm not trying to pull the wool of their eyes, right? They can see people like C.S. Lewis and other people that they really respect and like, oh, okay. And so they realize the kind of the complexity that's going on there.
Very true. Excellent. I'll move down and ask a question from an anonymous attendee. The second one on the list here, you argue that proper science begins with Christian assumptions. I believe this was more based on one of your earlier talk here, but maybe it's still relevant here. Can a Christian be right in their skepticism of science done by scientists that reject these assumptions?
Well, I think I would say it's more complicated. So I don't want to say there's a separate Christian science and that if scientists start with different assumptions, it's going to be wrong. I often think like when you get into like lab or to real science, you're actually engaging the world. You're coming up, like you go into a biology lab and you're doing all this engagement and this technique of the world. And so someone could have an entirely different assumption for you, but you can still get the experiment to work out. And so I feel like to say to reject the science is to reject the empirical data, which is the most valuable part of what's going on there. And so I think it's perfectly reasonable to say that someone who is really trying to make sense of that data and take it seriously might reach a different conclusion. But, you know, in some ways, I think you have to leave that up to the actual specialist in that area. Sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. And that's why I think it's better to have, the long-term strategy is to have as many Christians in science as possible to help us make those decisions about where's things that we need to, oh yeah, this is really, take it to the bank. Science has really shown us this versus things that need to be pressed on a little bit more to see if we can develop that. There might be a little bit alternative ways of explaining that particular empirical data.
Yeah, excellent point. We certainly do need more Christians in the field of science. And I think one of the ways that we can do that is by having events like this, where we talk about science and faith and show that there is no conflict, that conflict is perceived, and there's a lot that we can learn all together here. I'll move on to a question from Leighton. What can churches or pastors do to encourage people to have a healthy view of science in the environment we live in now?
That's a good one. I mean, I feel like in some ways promoting personal stories of people in your congregation would be helpful. Like if you happen to have scientists in your congregation, allowing them to talk and celebrating them and their discovery would be important. I think that there's a lot of science that raises issues of awe and wonder about the world. And so I think naturally working in like discoveries of the awe of the world is really would be kind of a good strategy to kind of recognize that, you know, all faith, you know, if you come up, if you show confidence to the congregation that you're confident that faith and science can work well together, I think that will show in sermons and other interactions with folks. And so I would say the two things off the top of my mind: celebrate the scientists that you have there, and maybe you know, encourage them to have a voice in your church, and also take a kind of an attitude of curiosity, a wondrous curiosity towards science is a good model of the behavior to model for your congregation.
Yeah, that's an excellent response. I'll move through here and see if I can pick a bit of a different question here. So Paul's question is a little bit long, kind of down the list, but I think it takes a bit of a different stance than some of the others here. So Paul writes, Dr. Reeves, you mentioned that you would like to see more rigorous debate among experts, yet it seems that those who give opinions that express dissent from certain views become targets of gaslighting by media and even lawmakers. Even worse, some are labeled conspiracy theorists, even when they are actually some of the scientists with the most expertise. For instance, Dr. Pina McCullough, I believe I'm reading that name well, who has been very critical of the COVID vaccines, has published over 600 peer-reviewed articles, including 50 articles on SARS-CoV-2 and the vaccines. Do you think we are sometimes guilty of gaslighting ourselves as Christians?
I mean, I feel like this issue is complicated, right? Because I feel like no matter how much a scientific community feels like it knows something, you're always going to find one really credentialed scientist out there who disagrees, right? And so if the standard of believing something is that there has to be 100% uniform agreement in the scientific community, will never reach that standard. And so the question is, how much diversity do we allow in the community? And I feel like that's really honestly a question for the scientific community itself to answer, right? And so I feel very nervous where if social media and journalists get involved in policing scientific norms, because I just feel like that's entirely undermining to the whole scientific process. And I also feel uncomfortable when scientists who have a contrarian view take their view straight to the public rather than to other scientists. I feel like that's oftentimes where a lot of Christian apologists get in trouble, is that you have a PhD who comes, speaks to your church, but the message is entirely for lay people who have no ability to assess what's going on. And most everybody in the actual scientific community would say, no, that's not possible to be the case, right? And so I feel like robust debate within the scientific community, we need to find all the ways possible to do that while admitting that sometimes the scientific community has to shut off debate and say, we've just, at this point, we've exhausted this, we're going in this direction. It doesn't mean new evidence can't come up that reopens the debate, but I do think it is entirely appropriate, say, for example, for a scientific journal to say, hey, we're just not going to talk about the Earth as the center of the solar system anymore. I think we just kind of know that, right? So there has to be some limits to debate, because for any intellectual debate, right? And so that balance is a hard one. And I don't know if I can give a one size fits all answer, but encouraging debate is extremely important and healthy. Sometimes you have to cut it off, and we just need to keep as much as possible journalists and social media out of that debate, because I just think it just creates polarization where it just creates a whole difficulty for people to really trust institutions when that happens.
Yeah, that's an excellent point. Certainly as a scientist, I'm accustomed to writing about my research in scientific articles and talking about it in our institutions. We have places like that for critical thought and debate and discussion, and it should be kept in those areas among experts, and certainly much debate happens there.
Yeah, so I would say, like, for example, it's entirely appropriate to raise a question and say, hey, this scientist says this, what do you say about that? But to come in and try to, as a layperson, say, you're silencing this person, you're intellectually unserious or something like that, that to me is overstepping the boundaries, because for someone who has actual expertise, they may see it differently, because they may see the specialist knowledge may change their perception. And if most specialists in a discipline who come from different backgrounds think that it's not a live option, then I do think we should, the likelihood is that is more likely to be correct than the lone person, saying everything is wrong or crying wolf or something like that.
Well, thank you so much, Dr. Reeves. I think that is a good place to end our session here this morning. And I thank you. Hope everyone can join me in thanking you for just your wise talks today and your excellent responses in our Q&A sessions.
Yeah, it's been wonderful to be here. Thank you.